So today I'll be discussing about multi-stage MOS amplifier. In fact, in the last few classes, I have talked about a single-stage MOS amplifier, and I have also discussed about three different types of configurations, namely a common source stage, a common drain stage, and the common gate stage. Now today, more specifically, I'll be emphasizing on the common source, common gate type of cascade configuration, and which is normally told as a cascode. And the name came from this cascade triode, from this particular topology. Now, as you know, for a common source amplifier, a common source MOS amplifier, the input is applied at the gate terminal, and the output is obtained from the drain terminal, and the source is considered to be common. And for common gate configuration, the input is applied at the source terminal, and the output is obtained from the drain terminal, where gate is considered to be common. Now, if I consider a common source, common gate kind of cascade configuration, so let me first try to draw the circuit diagram for a common source, common gate cascade. So since we have started with a common source kind of configuration, so let me just draw this NMOS amplifier. So the input is applied at the gate of this NMOS, and let me call this gate as, I mean, this MOS as M1. So the input signal is applied over here. So this is the gate terminal where the input is applied, source is grounded, and the output is obtained at the drain terminal. Now this output is to be fed at the source terminal of a common gate stage. So therefore, this output is connected to the source terminal of a common gate stage, and the drain of this second MOS, that is M2, is connected to the supply, that is VDD, with a resistance say RD, and the input is applied to the source, and the corresponding gate potential here, it is constant. So let this gate potential be represented by V of P. And the final output for this common source, common gate cascade is obtained from this terminal, that is the drain of the second MOS. So this is the common source stage. So this one is the common source stage, CS stage. And this one is the common gate stage. Sorry. This one is the common gate stage. So common source, common gate. So initially the input is applied at the gate of the first amplifier, and the output of the first amplifier is obtained over here. And let me call this output to be, let me just identify this output to be, say, V dashed. And this is being fed to the input of the second MOS, which is acting in common gate configuration. So gate is considered to be at AC ground. So the potential at the gate terminal for the second MOS is constant, it's kept at VB, and the output is obtained from the drain 2 of the second MOS. Now, already we have discussed about the different regions of operations for MOS, and we have also explained why always we prefer to operate the MOS in the saturation region so as to increase the value of the mutual conductance or transconductance. So here also, whenever we are using these two configuration like common source and common gate in a cascade fashion, then our objective will be to operate both of these two devices in the saturation region. And for that, we have to find out the relationship between the different terminal voltages. Now to start with, if I just consider the first MOS, that is M1. So here, you know that in order to make M1 to be in the saturation, the condition is that drain to source voltage should be greater than the gate to source voltage minus the threshold voltage, that is overdrive voltage. So here the drain to source voltage is nothing but MV dashed. So this should be greater than or equal to the overdrive voltage, that is, we can write this overdrive voltage as VGS, minus VTH1. Now this condition has to be satisfied to make M1 in the saturation. So if M1 is in saturation, then this condition has to be satisfied. Now obviously the relationship between VDAST and VB is governed by the gate to source voltage of the second MOS. So we can simply write that VB minus VDAST, that is nothing but the gate to source voltage of the second MOS. So in fact, we should write VGS1 over here because this is the gate to source voltage of the first MOS. So VB minus VDAST is nothing but the gate to source voltage of the second MOS. Now, in order to ensure that the second MOS, that is M2, is also operating in the saturation region, the condition is that the drain to source voltage should be greater than or equal to the gate to source voltage minus the threshold voltage of the second MOS. So we can write V out minus V dashed should be greater than or equal to VB minus V dashed minus the threshold voltage of the second MOS. So therefore, from this expression, what we can find is the drain to source voltage of the second MOS, that is V out minus V dashed. So in one word, we can write this V out minus V dashed, which is nothing but the drain to source voltage of the second MOS. So it should be greater than or equal to the gate to source voltage of the second MOS minus the threshold voltage of the second MOS, that is VGS2 minus VTH2. So we can write from this expression that V out, the output voltage, should be greater than or equal to V dashed plus VGS2 minus VTH2. And what is the minimum value for V dashed in order to make M1 in saturation? In fact, this condition is to be true to make M2 in saturation. So this condition holds good to make M2 in saturation. And we have to satisfy both of these two conditions. So the minimum possible value for V dashed to make M1 in saturation is VGS1 minus VTH1. So therefore, V out should be greater than or equal to VGS1 minus VTH1 plus VGS2 minus VTH2. And we can always identify the maximum possible value for V out. So the maximum possible value is nothing but VDD. So when there is no current that is flowing through these two MOSes like M1 and M2, then the drop across this particular resistance RD will be zero, and the output voltage V out can be written as simply VDD. So in fact, we can always write V out as VDD minus ID times RD. Now this V out achieves its maximum value when ID is minimum, and the minimum value of the drain current should be zero. So therefore, Vout max. So Vout max is equal to VDD, and Vout min is given by from this expression, that is, it should be greater than or equal to the summation of two overdrive voltages. So therefore, V out min is equal to VGS1 minus VTH1 plus VGS2 minus VTH2. If you just compare the V out max and V out min as obtained here with respect to what you already obtained for a simple common source kind of configuration, perhaps you can remember that if I do not have this upper MOS over here, and if I simply have this lower MOS and the drain is connected to the VDD through a resistance RD, then the minimum possible value for Vout would be equal to simply VGS1 minus VTH1. However, the maximum value is fixed, that is VDD. So therefore, if I just consider the swing of the output voltage, so for a simple common source stage, single stage common source amplifier, the output voltage swing is from VDD to VGS1 minus VTH1, or VDD to VGS minus VTH. However, if I consider a common source, common gate kind of cascade configuration, and which is also known as a cascode, so here the maximum value is fixed, and however, the minimum value has also been increased by an overdrive voltage. So while starting the discussion of a common source, common gate kind of cascade configuration, initially we have identified one of the limitation of this particular arrangement. The limitation is coming in the form of lower available output voltage swing. So that is one of the disadvantage or one of the limitation of this cascode configuration, but still we prefer this cascode configuration in many of the applications. And gradually I'll be discussing what are the different advantages that we are getting out of this cascode configuration. Now, if I just want to find out the variation of the output voltage with the corresponding variation input voltage, then we'll be getting one curve which is known as the transfer characteristics. Now, while discussing the transfer characteristics, let me very briefly draw the circuit diagram once again, because this will help us in explaining the behavior easily. So that is the circuit. We have two MOS like M2 and M1. And the base of M2 is held at a constant potential. And the base of M1 is connected to the input voltage, that is Vin. Now let us try to increase the value, and the output is obtained from this terminal, that is Vout. And let this potential equal to V dash. Now let us try to increase the value of V in from a very low value. Let's just start from zero and try to find out what is the corresponding value for V out. So this graph will give you the variation of the output voltage with respect to the input voltage. So as you understand, whenever the input voltage is less than the threshold voltage of this MOS, that means M1, then obviously this M1 will be off. And since M1 is off, there will be no current that will be flowing through the circuit, and V out will be equal to VDD. So to start with, as long as V in is less than VTH1, suppose this value is equal to VTH1. Let me just try to identify this point. Suppose this value equal to VTH1, the threshold voltage of the first MOS. Now, as long as V in is less than VTH1, the value of V out is fixed at VDD. Then what happens if you go on increasing the value of V in? If you increase the value of V in beyond this VTH1, then obviously M1 will be on, and M1 will be on in the saturation region. Why so? Because initially the gate to source voltage minus the threshold voltage is small as compared to the drain to source voltage. So therefore, the device becomes on in the saturation region. And as the device is on, so the current will be flowing through this particular series combination, cascade configuration. And as the current flows, so there will be some IDRD drop across this resistance, and automatically the V out will be less than the value of VDD. So V out will be reduced from the value of VDD. Now this will be continued, and the both of these two MOSes will be in the saturation region unless some conditions are satisfied. Now what are those conditions? Now let us try to identify those two conditions. Now as you go on increasing the value of V in, what happens? Both V out and V dashed will be dropped. So initially, if I just try to identify the value of V dashed whenever the MOS M1 is off, so that value, if I just call it like, I think it will be better if I use a different color. So for V out, let me just show it with the green. And for V dashed, let me show with the black. So when the input voltage is less than the threshold voltage of the first MOS, then obviously M1 is off and the value of V dash is equal to VB minus VTH2. So this value, so I think I can put V dash over here. So I'm just drawing two variables over a single graph. So the value will be equal to VB minus VTH2, approximately equal to VB minus VTH2 when the MOS M1 is off. Next, what happens when you go on increasing the value of VM? Then obviously the value of V out will be reduced as compared to RD, and more amount of current will be flowing through this combination because M1 is on now. And as the current increases in this particular configuration, so the gate to source overdrive for this particular MOS, second MOS, the gate to source overdrive must also increase, because we have assumed that both of these transistors, both of these two MOS will be on in the saturation region. And in the saturation region, as you understand, the drain current is proportional to the square of the overdrive voltage. So since the drain current increases, so therefore the gate to source voltage of both of these two MOSes will be increased. Now if I just consider the second MOS, so the gate voltage is constant, that is VB, but the source voltage is V dashed. So as you go on increasing the value of V in, the value of V dashed will be dropped down. And accordingly, we can have a fluctuation like this. We maybe have a fluctuation like this. And same is true for the V dashed. Now, when you go on increasing the value of V in, to a very large value, then what happens? As you go on increasing the value of V in, the gate to source voltage for this particular MOS, M1, is gone increasing. That means the overdrive voltage for this MOS is increasing. On the other hand, the drain to source potential, which is nothing but the value of V dashed, is reduced. So a point will come when you find that this V dashed is less than VGS minus VTH1, VGS1 minus VTH1, or a point will come. So this is, that can be equivalently said like, a point will come when V dashed is less than V in minus VTH1. Because if you select a very high value of V in, so this V in minus VTH1 will be large as compared to the value of V dashed. And then under this condition, the device M1 will enter into the triad region. M1 will enter into the triad region. Then automatically, the corresponding transconductance will be reduced. Similarly, if I just consider the second MOS, that is MOS 2, we'll also find that here, the gate potential is constant, that is VB, and the source potential is V dashed, and the drain potential is V out. So here, we have to compare the gate potential with the drain potential only, because the source is to be there for this particular comparison, because we have a gate to source in one side, gate to source minus threshold in one side, and drain to source in other side. So gate voltage is constant, and however, the drain voltage is reducing. So a point will come when you find V out will be less than VB minus VT is 2. And then it will make M2 in linear or triad region. Linear or triad. So both of them will carry the same meaning. Now, depending upon the value of VB and the value of the resistance RD, one event may appear before the other. So it depends upon the value of the bias potential that you are using at the gate 2 of MOS 2, that is M2, over here, and obviously it will also depend upon the value of the load resistance, that is RT. So one event may appear before the other. And if the transistors M1 and M2 enters into the triode or deep triode region, then obviously the transconductance of the MOS will be drastically reduced, and we cannot use it as an amplifier over there. So that is all about the large signal behavior of this common source common gate cascade. And this combination is also known as cascode, as I've already mentioned. Now, before saying anything further, let me just try to find out the small signal voltage gain for this combination. Now, while doing this, the calculation of small signal voltage gain, initially we will do some approximation, we'll make some assumption, and gradually we will remove all the assumption and find out the exact value for the voltage gain. So let me start with the assumption that the channel length modulation, the effect of the channel length modulation is absent. That means in the small signal equivalent circuit, we don't have any RO1 or RO2 present. So that is a simplistic model we are considering over here. And gradually we will be removing that approximation, and ultimately we will find some generic expression for the voltage gain. So this is the circuit diagram for a common source. So let me write over here. This is the cascode configuration. Cascode, common source, common gate, cascade. So let me start with the MOS one. So here you find that we have applied some input at the gate terminal. So this is the input voltage. And between gate to source, the voltage is V1. That is a normal practice we have used. And between drain to source, we have one voltage dependent current source, and whose magnitude is equal to GM1 times V1. So this is the source one, and this is grounded. Here we are not considering any channel length modulation, so there will be no R0. Rather, we can also say that there is an R0, but it is pretty large, infinite. So its appearance across this GM1 times V1 can be neglected, that can be omitted. So this is the drain one of the first MOS. Now let us try to understand what will be the corresponding small signal equivalent circuit for the second MOS. Now here you find that the gate potential is held constant, that is VB. So obviously this is equivalent to AC ground. And we do have this potential, let this potential with respect to source 2 of second MOS equal to V2. Now obviously we will be having GM2 times V2, that is the voltage dependent current source, and since the source of this MOS M2 is not connected to ground, so there will be some body effect. So body effect will not be there for M1 because the source of M1 is connected to ground potential, but for M2 the source is not connected to the ground potential. It is held at some other potential, so obviously we need to consider the effect of GMB and this is nothing but GMB 2 times VBS2, and obviously RD will be there between the drain and the ground, and this potential is V out. So we need to find out the ratio between V out and V in from this small signal equivalent circuit. It is very simple for a calculation. So first of all, you have to identify what is the value of VBS2. So VBS2 is nothing but VB2 minus VS2, and VB2 is zero, and VS2, the source potential here, as you find with respect to ground, the source potential is minus V2. So we have a minus or minus V2. So this is equal to V2. So since this potential is V out, so the current that will be flowing through this resistance RT from this point to ground is nothing but V out upon RD. And if you apply KCL, the current that will be flowing in this direction is nothing but minus V out times RT. And another thing what we can notice from here is that the V in value and V1, they are same. So V1 equal to V in. So minus V out by RD is entering over here. That is the total current that is flowing through the MOS 2, and the same current will be flowing through MOS M1 because they are in the series combination. So we can simply write that GM1 times V1 is equal to minus V out upon RT. So GM1 times V in, because V1 is equal to V in, is equal to minus V out upon RT. And which suggests that the voltage gain AV, which is the ratio of V out upon V in, is given by minus GM1 times RT. See, you might get astonished that even after using a common gate stage over here, there has been no improvement in the voltage gain. So you can simply get this GM1 times RT using a simple single stage common source amplifier. Then what is the need of adding this common gate stage over here? So I'm coming to that point. But remember, over here we have made a lot of approximations. We have not identified, we have not included the effect of the channel length modulation over here. That's why RO1 and RO2 are considered to be infinite. So that's why we can simply say that the effect of the second stage is omitted over here. But this is a simplistic expression for the voltage gain. But whenever we will be incorporating the RO1 value and RO2 value, I mean the finite RO1 and finite RO2, then you will see that the expression of the voltage gain will also be depending upon GM2 and GMB2. Now, in the next slide, I would like to do the same thing. So I'm not going into the circuit diagram once again because it will be the same thing. So the only modification what I need to do over here is the a corresponding change in the small signal model. So this is the only change. So we have a GM1 times V1 already. So this one was V in. And suppose this potential between gate two sources V1. So therefore, we have GM1 times V1. Now, apart from that, we have to incorporate RO1 also. Now we are going to calculate the exact expression for the voltage gain, incorporating the effect of the channel length modulation. Similarly, here also, as you can see, so suppose this potential is V2, and we do have GM root is V2, and the other current source in the form of GMV2 times VBS2. Now I am simply writing V2 because already you have seen that VBS2 is nothing but V2. And then we have the resistance, that is RO2, which is connected between the drain and the source of the second MOS. And then we have the resistance, that is RD. And this is Vout. So from this expression, from this small signal model, you have to find out the expression for the voltage gain. So what you can see over here, the current that is flowing in this direction is nothing but minus Vout upon RD. And if I assume that the current that is flowing through RO2 is given by IRO2, then the application of simple KCL will tell you that IRO2 is nothing but minus Vout by RT. So this is the total current minus GM2 plus GMV2 times V2. So we can simply identify that part. Then, considering this lower MOS, that is M1, we can identify the other criteria, that is V out can also be represented as the voltage drop across this resistance minus V2. So if I apply KVL over here, so you'll see that V out can also be represented like IRO2 times RO2 minus V2. So from that, we can simply put the value of IR2 over here. That is, I can write like minus. I can take minus outside. V out upon RD plus GM2 plus GMV2 times V2 whole multiplied with RO2 minus V2. And this expression will give you the relation between V out and V2. So V out into 1 plus RO2 upon RD is given by minus V2 1 plus GM2 plus GMV2 times RO2. So from that we can simply write V2 to be equal to minus V out into 1 plus RO2 by RD divided by this entire expression. That is 1 plus GM2 plus GM by 2 times RO2. So this expression equates V2 with V out. Now, if we apply the KCL once again over here, if we apply KCL over here, you'll see that the total current that is entering over here is minus V out upon RD. And that has been divided into two different components. That is, one component is GM times V1, and the other component is the current that is flowing through RO1. And that current is nothing but minus V2 upon RO1. So just by applying KCL over here at this particular node, that means at the source 2 of this particular configuration, will give us minus V out by RD, that is the total current, is equal to GM times V, GM1 times V1 minus V2 by RO1. So V1, as you know, is nothing but V in minus V2 by RO1. Now we have to put the value of V2 over here. Already we have calculated in the last slide, that is minus V out into 1 plus RO2 by RD. So minus V2, so we should write plus V out into 1 plus RO2 by RD divided by 1 plus GM2 plus GM2 times RO2, yes, RO2. So from that, what we can do is we can just multiply both the numerator and denominator, I mean, both the left hand side and right hand side with RD, and then it will give us minus V out is equal to GM1 RD times V in plus V out into RD plus RO2 divided by 1 plus GM2 plus GMB2 times RO2. So taking V out in one side, we can write V out into 1 plus RT plus RO2 divided by 1 plus GM2 plus GMB2 times RO2. So I think I have missed some RO1 over here. There was an RO1. I have just missed that part. So I have just written the expression for V2 over here. So this entire thing will be just multiplied with RO1. So this is multiplied with RO1, and that is equal to minus GM1 RD times Vin. So if I just simply calculate this expression inside the bracket, this will give us V out multiplied with RO1 plus RO2 plus RD plus GM2 plus GMV2 times R1, R2. R1, R2. And in the denominator, we should have 1 plus GM2 plus GMV2 times RO2 and the whole multiplied with RO1. And that is equal to minus GM1 times RT times V in. So from this expression, we can find out the final value for the voltage gain involving all the parameters into consideration. So AV, which is nothing but the ratio between V out and V in, can be represented like minus GM1 times RT. So already we have this part, GM1 times RT, and then it gets multiplied with this one. It gets multiplied with 1 plus GM2 plus GMV2 times RO2, and this gets multiplied with RO1. And divided by, in the numerator, we have RO1 plus RO2 plus RD plus GM2 plus GMB2 into RO1, RO2. Let me just check whether I have written the proper expression or not. Yeah, RO1, RO2, RD, GM2 plus GMB2 times RO1, RO2. So that gives the final expression of the voltage gain involving all the parameters like GM1, GM2, GMB2, RO1, RO2, and all. And this is the expression for the overall voltage gain for a cascode amplifier. Now, from this generic expression, one can easily find out the expression which we have already got in some previous slides, that we have already found out the value of AV with lambda 1 and lambda 2 equal to 0. That means R1 and R2 equal to infinite. And that value was minus GM1 times RT. So you can get the same expression. You can also verify that the voltage gain, what you have got over here, the expression for the voltage gain, this entire expression can be from this expression. You can verify if you put RO1 tending towards infinity, RO2 tending towards infinity, you can verify the value of AV is equal to minus GM1 times RT. So I'm not going into the mathematical deduction of that part, but you can simply verify. I would like to mention one point, that this is the final expression for the voltage gain. I mean, the generic expression for the voltage gain. And you can always get the value for a specific case, like with lambda 1 equal to lambda 2 equal to 0, by putting R1 and R2 a value which is equal to or which is approaching towards infinity. So from this generic expression, you can always find out the value for a specific voltage gain. Now, sometimes we prefer to use a current source load. In fact, in our discussion on common source stage of amplification, we have discussed what are the advantages of using a current source load instead of having a simple resistance like RD. Now, if you have a current source load, that means if I have a situation like this, so cascode amplifier is having a current source load, and if I consider ideal current source for which the impedance is infinite. So this one is Vm, this one is Vb, and we're taking the output from this terminal. Now instead of using a discrete resistance like RT, now we are using a current source load. Then what should be the value of the voltage gain? So as you know, for a current source load, the load resistance RT is very large, and ideally we can think it to be close to infinity. So for this particular configuration, we can simply find out the value for the voltage gain AV with RT tending towards infinity. That is nothing but the voltage gain of the cascode source, I mean cascode stage, with a simple current source as load. So if I just substitute this particular condition, we'll see that in the numerator you have minus GM1 RO1 into 1 plus GM2 plus GMV2 times RO2, and the denominator we have this RD plus this entire thing divided by RD. So you can simply verify the denominator you have only one, because if you divide this entire thing RO1 plus RO2 plus GMV2 plus GM2 into RO1 RO2 divided by RD with the limit RD tending towards infinity, so this will give you zero, and RD by RD will give you one only. So ultimately the voltage gain with RD tending towards infinity is given by minus GM1 RO1 into this one, and that can be approximated if we consider that the value of this transconductance is large. So that can be approximated to be minus GM1 times RO1 into, I mean, this one can be just neglected with respect to this GMR0 product. So then it will be like GM2 plus GMB2 times RO2, and which is nothing but the product of the individual gain. So GM1 times RO1 is the gain resulting from the first stage, that is a common source stage, and for a common gate stage, the gain voltage gain is given by GM into 1 plus eta times RD. So what you can find here, so this is nothing but the overall voltage gain can be obtained as the individual product of the common source stage and common gate stage voltage gain. So we have to identify the generic expression for the voltage gain, and from the generic expression one can easily find out any specific case. Now with this understanding, let us try to identify another important advantages of this cascode amplifier, and the advantage is coming in the form of very high output impedance. And in fact, this is the one of the important attributes of this cascode stage. So cascode stage will always give you very high output impedance, and therefore in some of the applications, instead of using cascode as an amplifier, we can always, or we can also implement cascode as a current source load as well. Now we will discuss this issue later on. Now before that, if I have a cascode amplifier like this, let me consider a current source load over here. Or in fact, what you can do, you can also consider a situation where some finite resistance is present. So that is up to you. So since we have already discussed about the current source load, so therefore it will be better if I just stick into that. So this is the second MOS, first MOS, VB, VIN. And the output is obtained from this terminal. Now, if I would like to find out the output impedance, the normal practice, as you know, we have to disable this externally applied input signal, and we need to apply some external voltage at the output end. It will be Vx, and we have to identify what is the current that is being drawn by the circuit itself, and the ratio of this Vx upon Ix will give us the value of the output impedance. So with this understanding, since Vin is disabled, so the gate is it is at AC ground. And here, say this difference is V1. So this one is GM1 times V1. And apart from that, we have to identify RO1. And the source is grounded, as you already understand. Now, as far as the small signal model for the upper MOS is concerned, we can have a similar kind of scenario. So, suppose this difference is V2. So, we'll be having GM2 times V2. And obviously, we need to incorporate the body effect. So GM V2 times V2. Then we do have the resistance, that is RO2, connected between the drain and source of the second MOS. And now we have to apply some external voltage. Let this voltage be Vx, and suppose the current that is flowing, that is being drawn by the circuit, is Ix. So the output resistance can be written like Vx upon Ix. So for the calculation, let us assume that when Ix is flowing in this direction, the current that is flowing through RO2 is along this direction, and the current that is flowing through RO1 is along this direction. Now with this indication, the current that is flowing through RO2, that is IRO2, can be written as Ix minus GM2 plus GMV2 times V2. And we can also identify the current that is flowing through RO1. Now, what is the current that is flowing through RO1? You have to identify that current. In fact, that current can be easily obtained from this small signal model, because we have already seen that V1, which is nothing but the difference between gate to source. So here V1 is seen to be zero, because the gate is at AC ground, so as the source. So therefore, this GM1 V1, that particular current source, will be inactive, since V1 is equal to zero. So the total current that is entering, that is Ix, so the same current will be flowing through RO1. And the voltage that is developed across RO1 is minus V2. So we can write this IRO1, the current that is flowing through the resistance RO1. So this IRO1 is nothing but Ix, and that is equal to minus V2 upon RO1. So IRO1 is equal to Ix, and that is equal to minus V2 upon RO1. Then we have to equate this Vx to be the voltage drop across RO2, that is IRO2 into RO2, plus the voltage drop across RO1. And we already identify that the voltage drop across RO1 is nothing but minus V2. That is nothing but minus V2. So we can simply write this is equal to Vx equal to IRO2 RO2 minus V2. And from this expression, we can also equate V2 to be minus Ix RO1. So putting this value, IRO2 can be written like Ix minus GM2 plus GMV2 times V2, and that gets multiplied with RO2 minus V2. So now we can put the value of V2 over here. So we have Ix minus, so V2 is equal to minus Ix times RO1. So we have GM2 plus GMV2 times Ix RO1, and this entire thing is multiplied with RO2, and plus we have Ix RO1. So if you just simply take the ratio R out, that is equal to Vx upon Ix. So this will give you RO1 plus 1 plus GM2 plus GMV2 times RO1 and whole multiplied with RO2. So this can be equivalently written as, so we have four terms over here. One is RO1, second one is RO2, then GM2 times RO1 RO2, and GMV2 times RO1 RO2. Now this can be equivalently written as RO2 plus 1 plus GM2 plus GMV2 times RO2 whole multiplied with RO1. Now we will gradually see the implication of this kind of representation whenever we consider a cascode kind of load as a current source load. So the output impedance, as we find over here, so output impedance for a cascode combination is given by RO2 plus 1 plus GM2 plus GMV2 times RO2 multiplied with RO1. Now, if I consider that this GM RO product is larger with respect to 1, so then that entire expression of R out can be approximated to be, GM2 plus GMV2 times RO1, RO2. Now, this is a great improvement in terms of the output impedance. As you find over here, the overall output impedance is given by, with some approximation, we have just neglected this one with respect to this GM RO product. So that is equal to GM2 plus GMV2 multiplied with RO1, RO2. And because of this very high value of the output impedance, so this cascode stage, common source with a common gate cascade, so cascode stage can equivalently be used as a simple load, as a current source load. Because we know for a current source, the corresponding output impedance or the impedance provided by the current source is pretty large. So therefore, instead of using a simple MOS combination, simple single stage MOS configuration, we can also use a cascode kind of configuration to implement a current source. In fact, we can even for this circuit, what we have drawn over here, for this circuit even, we can simply substitute this current source by means of a cascode load. Now here, let me consider a PMOS, NMOS type of cascode. That means the load is being implemented by means of PMOS cascode, and the source is, the amplifier is being represented by means of NMOS cascode. So this is the current source load that you're talking about. So two NMOS and two PMOS like this. So this one is the supply line. Now we are applying the input over here. This is MOS 1, this is MOS 2, and this is a MOS 3, and this is MOS 4. And suppose the potential over here is VB2, VB3, and VB4. And we'll be taking the output from this terminal. So this is the Vout terminal. So here you find that this is a common source stage followed by a common gate, and this one is a common source stage followed by a common gate. Now this configuration, this M3 M4 configuration, is nothing but, so this is equivalent to a current source. So the current source load is being implemented by means of this M3 M4 combination, M3 M4 common source common gate configuration. And these two MOS, M1 and M2, they are using as an amplifier. So the expression which we have already obtained over here, so from this expression of this output impedance, that was like GM2 plus GMB2 times RO1 into RO2. So that particular thing we can simply implement over here, and we can simply write down the load impedance as given by this particular combination. So we can equivalently write the value of RD. So what is RD over here? We can write this RD to be 1 plus GM3 plus GMB3 times RO3 whole multiplied with RO4 plus we have RO3. Because out of these two MOS, M3 and M4, M3 is suffering from body effect. Because for the MOS M4, its source is already connected to the VDD, and which is equal to AC ground. So therefore, M4 is not suffering from any body effect. So we have to incorporate the effect of this GMB for MOS 3 only, and accordingly the resistance RD, the equivalent resistance over here, can be represented from this particular form, as you can see, 1 plus GMB2 plus GM2 into RO2 whole multiplied with RO1 plus you have RO2. So just like this, RT can be represented like 1 plus GM3 plus GMB3 times RO3 whole multiplied with RO4 plus RO3. And what about the output impedance of this particular configuration, this M1, M2 configuration? So if I call this output impedance as, say, R out, and we have already calculated this expression for R out. So this is nothing but 1 plus GM2 plus GMB2 times RO2 whole multiplied with RO1 plus you have RO2. Now both of these two resistances, RD and ROUT, they are connected in shunt between this terminal and ground, between this terminal and C ground. So if I would like to find out the overall output resistance ROUT overall, so this R out overall can be represented as the parallel combination, shunt combination between RT and R out. So obviously this will give you very large value of overall output impedance, that is fine. But this particular configuration is having some serious limitation in terms of the voltage swing. Now let us try to understand what is meant by that. Now let me once again, I think I can once again draw the same circuit. So we have 2 PMOS and 2 NMOS. So PMOS devices are used as the load, code load, and NMOS devices are used as amplifier. So this is the supply VDD. Let this be M4, this be M3, this be M2, this be M1, and this one is the output terminal. Input is applied over here, and we have some fixed bias potential at the gate of M2, M3, and M4. So let it be VB3, VB2, VB4 respectively. So as you know, in order to use this entire thing as a cascode amplifier, where both the amplifier or amplifying devices and the load are used in cascode fashion, so the condition that we have to establish over here is that all the MOSes like M1, M2, M3, and M4, they must be acting in the saturation region. And you know the condition for acting the devices in the saturation region. The condition is that the gate to source voltage should be, I mean, gate to source minus the threshold voltage, that overdrive voltage should be less than the drain to source voltage. Now if I call this point as Vx, I mean the potential at this point at Vx, and potential over here is Vy. Then for the NMOS, if I just consider for M1 to be in the saturation, the condition is that Vx should be greater than or equal to VGS1 minus VTH1. It should be greater than or equal to the overdrive voltage, and Vx is nothing but the drain to source voltage for MOS1. And what about MOS2? For MOS2, we find Vout minus Vx, that is the drain to source voltage for the MOS2, should be greater than or equal to the gate to source voltage of MOS2 minus the threshold voltage, that is overdrive voltage. So even if I select the terminal value, I mean the value at the edge of saturation or at the edge of triode region, then we find that V out should be greater than equal to VGS1 minus VTH1 plus VGS2 minus VTH2. So already we have seen that part in the very first slide, that the overdrive voltage should be added I have two MOS like M1 and M2. So the output voltage, the minimum value of the output voltage is given by the summation of the overdrive voltage. So that is all about the minimum value of the overdrive, the output voltage. Then what about the maximum possible value? Will it be VDD or will it be something else? That you have to identify from these two MOS, like M3 and M4, which are acting as the load. Now, since both of these two MOS are PMOS, so therefore the condition is the modulus of the drain to source voltage should be greater than or equal to the modulus of the overdrive voltage. So therefore, we can write for this MOS M3, or let me start with, I can start with M3 first. So here the condition is the drain to source voltage, that means mod of V out minus VY. This is the drain to source voltage mod of that. So it should be greater than or equal to mod of VGS3 minus VTH3. And since you understand that VY is less than VDD but greater than V out, so therefore the mod value, if I just eliminate the mod, so it will be nothing but VY minus V out. So that turns out to be positive, VY minus V out. So it should be greater than VGS3 minus VTH3. Then what about the fourth MOS, that is M4? So for the fourth MOS, the drain to source voltage, that is mod of VY minus VDD. So it should be greater than or equal to mod of VGS4 minus VTH4. Now here, this mod can be written like VDD minus VY, because VDD is the maximum possible voltage in the circuit. So VDD minus VY is positive. So it should be greater than or equal to mod VGS4 minus VTH4. So what you can do over here is that the value of VY, we can simply put the value of VY over here. From this expression, we can find that VDD, I think I can go to the next slide so that I can find some place also. Let me just write down what you have already got. One condition is VY minus V out. It is greater than or equal to mod VGS3 minus mod VTH3. And the second condition, what you have got, it was like VDD minus VDD minus VY. VDD minus VY. This is greater than or equal to mod VGS4 minus VTH4. So now, if I just consider this last expression first, so it suggests that VY should be less than or equal to VDD minus mod VGS4 minus VTH4. Now, if I put the hello Vi in this expression, we find that. So here, Vi should be less than or equal to that value. So that is the maximum possible value for Vi. So that the MOS4 is in the saturation region. Now, with this maximum possible value, if I would like to find out the value of Vout, we find VDD minus mod VGS4 minus VTH4 minus Vout it should be greater than or equal to mod of VGS3 minus VTH3. So we are using here the maximum possible value for Vy over here so that this difference can be made as high as possible. So this is the overdrive voltage for the, this is the drain to source voltage for the third MOS, that is MOS3. So we'd like to make this difference, this drain to source voltage, as high as possible. So here we have selected a value of Vy, which is the maximum possible. What is the maximum possible value for Vy? This is nothing but VDD minus mod VGS4 minus VTH4. Now with this, we can find that if I take V out in the other side, we will find that V out is limited by V out should be less than or equal to VDD minus mod VGS3 minus VTH3 minus mod VGS4 minus VTH4. So now we can identify the maximum and the minimum values for Vout. So we can find that Vout minimum, as obtained in the last slide, so it should be greater than equal to VGS1 minus VTH1 plus VGS2 minus VTH2. So therefore, Vout minimum is given by the summation of the two overdrive voltages. And what about the Vout maximum? So already we have seen this Vout minimum in the first slide also. But the maximum value of the Vout is now limited to not VDD, rather VDD minus this, because we have just implemented this load by means of a cascode configuration. So VGS4 minus VTH4. So what we find here, as compared to simple cascode amplifier, whenever we have this M3 and M4 acting as a load, so the Vout max is reduced from VDD. So the Vout max is not equal to VDD. It's now VDD minus the summation of the two overdrive voltages. However, the minimum value of the overdrive, minimum value of the output voltage is fixed to be the summation of the two overdrive voltages. So from this, the maximum possible swing of the output voltage, the maximum possible swing. So all these conditions are obtained with maximum possible voltage swing. The maximum possible output voltage. So I should be specific. That voltage is nothing but the output voltage. So the maximum possible output voltage swing is given by, so this is the maximum, this is the minimum. So the difference between these two. So this is nothing but VDD minus VGS1 minus VTH1 minus VGS2 minus VTH2 minus mod VGS3 minus VTH3 minus mod VGS4 minus VTH4. So we are getting better output impedance whenever we are using a cascode kind of load in the cascode amplifier. but at the cost of what? At the cost of limited output voltage swing. Now with this, I have come to the end of this cascode amplifier, and also at the end of unit 2 of our course, that is on MOS amplifier.